church. It's so good to be gathered here together on this beautiful Sunday morning. Let's stand together as we worship and give the Lord some praise that He is so worthy of.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Praise Him in glad adoration.
Church, we sing that one more time.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Praise Him in glad adoration. You are the Lord.
Was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way. The sin that promised joy and life had led me to the grave. I had no hope, no, a rebel to Your will. And if You had not loved me first, I would refuse You still. Yeah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. My hellbound race, indifferent to the cost, looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. And I beheld God's love's display, Your sin put in my place. For the wrath reserved for me, now all I know is grace. And yeah, all I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus said, Alone and live so all might see the strength to follow your commands could never come for me. Oh, Father, use my ransom life in any way you choose, and let my soul forever be my only boast is you. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus saved.
She King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven, sure you bright heaven sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still
people confess that our minds are scattered, our hearts are divided, and God, we want to want you, and we want to follow you, but God, so much of the time we miss the mark for where our heart and our minds are and where we want to be. So God, I just pray for the people in this room who feel that tension, that wrestle. Like, God, I want you to be my sole prize, my treasure. And I want to have a heart and life surrendered to say, God, I will go. Wherever you're leading, I want to listen to your voice and be with you in the moment. And so, God, this morning I just pray that you would allow us to be present. God, that whatever distractions are in place, that you would remove them by your power, God. Father, we would just be ready and open and willing to receive whatever you have for us this morning. Father, we love you and we want you. And if we don't, God, we want to want you. And so I pray all of this just in the matchless name of Jesus and by the power of your Holy Spirit, God. Amen. Church, we're not having a fellowship moment today, and so you guys can be seated. We have some announcements for you.
Well, good morning, church. Great to see you today. Still getting to know everybody here. My name's Kirk Rowland, on staff as the Executive Director of Operations, and I'm here to introduce, before we do our giving moment, a little bit about our generosity campaign that's happening starting this week in the midst of our Global Focus Month. And you may have received one of these cards on the way in. It's called Margin for Mission. And just to explain a little bit about what that is, first and foremost, it's a continuation of a generosity initiative that we started in December and going into January. And the goal of that generosity campaign is to simply to allow us to have margin to do all the things that God has called us to do in this fiscal year. And as we're ending our fiscal year here of the next few months, we are continuing that campaign. If you weren't here during that period, or if you didn't know the results of that, it provided a lot of fruit here for us. First and foremost, we asked the church to raise $200,000 above and beyond our normal giving and our normal tithes. And it produced a lot of fruit. Actually, about 26% of that was raised, $51,000. But additionally to that money, we had asked our church to provide gifts so that we could renovate our connecting point, which is instrumental in feeding and ministering to our community and our neighbors over in the Rivermont campus. We're pleased to announce that that project was fully funded. The renovations have been done, and we opened up and are now, ministering to our neighbors at a weekly basis, actually starting last week. So we're really excited about that, and we praise God for those things. Also in that, we asked 75 new givers, people who are connecting with Gospel Community Church, to give for the first time and engage in obedience and be a part of what Gospel Community Church is doing. And we had 35 people connect with us for the very first time. So this margin for mission, again, is a continuation of what we've been doing. And if we don't receive these funds, the church isn't going to shut down. We don't have to lay off Pastor Andrew, or at least I don't think we have to. But we, are doing these things just so that we can do more with the resources that God has given us. And as we enter into our second week of our global focus, we want to send people. And we want to know that people can go, but some people are to support those who go. So a little bit about Margin for Mission in its the particulars. We just chose four categories that would resonate most with the people who connect with Gospel Community Church. And on that card and, on our website, you can find this information as well. But we're encouraging our college students, when they are here during their semesters and in the fall and the spring, our attendance goes up. They are participants in volunteerism in Kid City and GSM and in worship and production. And we're so appreciative of them. But we're challenging our college students to leave a $100 summer gift so that we can continue serving our community here in College Hill through organizations like Village 434, and also at our connecting point over in the Rivermont campus. So we're asking our college students to forego a pair of shoes, a pair of jeans, maybe something fun that they were going to do this summer, and we're inviting them to do that. We're also, identifying or connecting with those who are involved in our next-gen ministries. We are growing in that area. In fact, just this past month, we hired a student ministries director. And with that student ministries director, they're going to need some resources there. We're expanding our spaces, expanding some spaces in Kid City. So because of that growth, we just want to have margin to do some of the missional elements that God is calling us to there. We are also doing something that resonates with me, asking people who want to be legacy givers and give a legacy gift. What's happening here at College Hill, which I'm very excited about, there are some nonprofit organizations that are officing out of this building here. So not only is our building used during the weekend, but it's also going to be used during the week, and they're going to be helping us pay all of those utilities. And Lynchburg Crew is officing here, and at the end of next month, Proven Men Ministries will be officing out of our basement area. I call it the terrace level because it sounds more swanky than that. So they're going to take over that whole room there, and with monthly helping us out with the utilities, they're going to be able to use that space. And that ministry helps battle the epidemic of pornography all across our nation. So we're able to use our facilities with what's happening here locally and regionally. But beyond that, with our legacy gifts, we want to be a sending church. And you're going to hear a little bit today about people who are being sent. Last week, we commissioned an individual, not going to mention their name, because they're going to a closed country where it is illegal to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. But through your generosity, we're able to send this individual to a place where they have been called to show the love of Jesus Christ and tell people about Jesus. And with Margin for Mission, we want to do more of that, not less. Finally, we're going to be asking people who have, are continually engaging with the Gospel Community Church to initiate their gifts and join us in what God is doing both here locally and beyond. So at this time, I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, and we're just going to pray over a time of giving and ask that you would prayerfully give as the Lord leads you. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, as we collect these gifts, Father, Lord, we stand and we pause knowing that our entire lives belong to you. Father, as we give these gifts, Father, we pray that we would be good stewards, that you would lead us in the direction of how you want us to spend these gifts. So it'd be first and foremost honoring to you. And Lord, that we would have opportunities to continue to reach both here in our local community and in our global community and connect with our global partners, you know, more as well. So Father, we give you this giving moment. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Just a few more announcements as we continue in our giving moment. First of all, if you're new here to Gospel Community Church, if you wouldn't mind taking some time to take a picture of that QR code in front of you, we'd love to connect with you through our online connection card. And if you are a volunteer here, we are having our heart and soul gathering where us as a staff want to serve you as volunteers, because you as volunteers are the heart and soul. And we're going to be having that from 4 to 6 p.m. If you've already signed up for that, just a reminder, please bring a camp chair or a blanket. I've also reminded that you should bring sunscreen and bug spray. So go ahead and do that this afternoon as well. We are encouraging you to serve with us for the summer as our college students are going to be heading back to their hometowns. We're going to have some much needed help in worship and production, Kids City, our GSM program. So we'd love for you to connect with us. And through that QR code, you can learn about places that you can serve. And also, the last one here specifically for College Hill is on May 5th. We're taking our two services at 9/11, and we're combining them into having one service at 10 a.m. each and every week, and that's going to be happening from the first week of May through the first week of August until our college students arrive back. And we wanted to let you know about that plenty ahead of time so that you could arrange your schedules to do so. So as we continue in worship through the Word, would you bow your heads with me as we pray? Dear Lord Jesus, Father, as we come into this place, as we are now, Lord, going to worship through the Word, Father, I pray for Austin as they have impressed upon his heart what you want him to share with us today. Father, I pray that his words will be your words. Father, as we read through the Scripture, as we are challenged today, Lord, I pray that our hearts would be open to your leading and what you want to do in the midst of our individual lives and the midst of our church. So, Father, we pray that you would bless this time. Bless Austin as he comes to preach and teach. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. I have been asked at this time to let our GSM students know that you guys can be dismissed to head on upstairs. As they're heading out, I got to visit our volunteer appreciation farm spot yesterday, and it's pretty cool. It's going to be a really great time, so don't want to miss that. If you serve with us 4 to 6 today, make sure you look up the directions on our website, because it can be a little tricky to get to. But all right, last week we kicked off our Global Focus series by walking through Jesus's command in the Great Commission, which he says, "Go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them everything I've commanded you, and remember, I am with you always." And Pastor Andrew walked through this text, and he showed us that every follower of Jesus is commanded, not suggested, commanded to be involved in sharing his gospel with others in our homes, our communities, and our world. So this morning, we're going to focus on the world piece of that, leaving our home culture and going to a new culture with the gospel of Jesus. And I've been praying for you this morning. Yes, you. I have been praying two prayers. And my first prayer is that God would call some here today to take the gospel to the unreached peoples of the world. I've been praying this for a few weeks, whether he's already stirring your heart, he's been stirring it, whether today's the first time you ever think about it. I've just been praying that he would stir up and raise up people, and that this morning would be part of that journey for you. And my second prayer is that everyone here would know and care about God's heart and plan for saving all the peoples of the earth. And I'm also aware that these desires are completely impossible without the Holy Spirit moving in our hearts and our minds. I do not call, God calls. I'm simply here to point to Scripture, to tell you what I see in it, what I'm convicted of, and pray that the Lord moves in hearts and minds as He wills. And so, no matter where you're at on missions this morning, whether you think you're called or not called, would you join me in pausing for a prayer of surrender? Would you pray with me, God, would you do whatever you want in my heart this morning? So I'm going to pause and give us a chance to pray that, and then we'll jump in. God, would you do whatever you want in my heart as I teach this morning? Would you do whatever you want in the hearts and minds of my brothers and sisters here? God, would you let your word be proclaimed, not my bias, not my confidence, not my insecurities, nothing else of me, God. Let this be your word. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to start this morning at the end, the back of the book. Does anyone, by chance, read the last page of a book before you read it? It's okay, this is a safe space. Just kidding, it's not a safe space. I don't know how you do that. Sorry. But as Christians, we do get to see the ending. So we're going to be in Revelation 7, verse 9. And it's here that we see the fulfillment of the Great Commission. Jesus gives this commission. Now, what does this turn into? Revelation 7, verse 9. This is John after Jesus shows him a glimpse of heaven. He says, "After this, I looked and I saw that there was a vast multitude from every nation, every tribe, every people, and every language, which no one could number, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. And they were clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice together, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb.' And all the angels stood around the throne, and along with the elders and the creatures, they fell on their faces before the throne, and they worshiped God. And they said, 'Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen.'" So as I read through this, I want to walk through this text asking a couple different questions. My first question is this: who is going to be at this gathering in heaven for eternity? And the answer is people who follow Jesus from every nation, tribe, people, and language. This is the language that verse 9 uses. But it's necessary for us here as Western Christians in America to redefine how we might think of the word nation. Jesus uses this word in Scripture, but when we read it in our English Bibles, I usually think of country, geopolitical nation, the U.S., Canada, China, India, and so on. But when Jesus and when the Bible uses this word in Scripture, it's actually the word ethne. It's where we get the word ethnic, and in Scripture, the word ethne is used to describe what we would call people groups. People groups are distinct ethnic groups with their own culture, their own language, their own barriers to access, and their own histories. And so what does this look like in practice? Well, in practice, we have the one country or nation of Nigeria, right? But in Nigeria, when we think of it using this way in Scripture, there is over 550 distinct ethne or nations or people groups. And Joshua Project is a resource that is dedicated to trying to identify all these people groups in the world. And so this is a map of what that looks like. This is a map of the roughly 17,000 people groups in our world today that make up 8 billion people. Don't worry about the colors. We're going to get there in a minute. And this matters because it's a lot more than the 200 countries we might see on a map, and it drastically changes how we understand the Great Commission. It's not just go to every country in the world and spread the gospel. It's bringing the gospel to all of the people groups of the world. The word ethne is what Jesus uses in his Great Commission. And so for the rest of this time together, I'm going to be using this language of people groups because I believe it's what Jesus is talking about in his word. So we know who's going to be there. At least one person from every people group will be in heaven together singing. Well, what are we going to be doing? We're going to be singing. We're going to be worshiping our Savior with one voice in the greatest multicultural worship gathering of all time. Church, this is our heaven song. This is more beautiful than any song that we could imagine. A worship gathering so large that you cannot number it. No football stadium on earth could hold it. No field could hold it. It is going to be an infinite-looking sea of people. And can you imagine what the roar of this worship is going to sound like? Can you imagine how loud our praises will be? I imagine them shaking the earth we stand on as we shout to our God. And can you imagine the beautiful diversity, the over 17,000 different traditions and cultures, skin tones, eye color, facial features, hair color, and all the different instruments as we sing together in one heavenly chorus? If you're a follower of Jesus, you better love diversity because it's coming. This is going to be our future. It is promised for those who follow Jesus. This isn't some idealistic dream. This isn't some wonky vision. This is written. This is going to happen. It is a glimpse of the future. And you and me who follow Jesus, we will be there. And so my last question, who can sing this song today? We can. We've been worshiping all morning. We've been singing. We can say salvation belongs to our God. But the reality is 40% of our choir is missing. 40% of the instruments are missing. 40% of people groups in the world today have no access to the gospel. Every red dot on that map represents a people group with little to no access to the gospel. That's over 3 billion people. We call these unreached people groups because there are people groups who have not yet been reached with the good news. But we don't really live in numbers. We don't think about dots when we think about countries and how we live. So I want to take a look at a simpler map that helps me a little more. And on this map, you're going to see 3 colors. The green shows places that have a somewhat common or significant access to Jesus, whether that's churches, Christians, bookstores, the internet. The yellow shows places with less access, less church presence, less Christians. And it's usually places that either used to have a strong presence and it declined, like most of Europe, or it's places that the church is starting and it's growing and it's new and it's gone from red to yellow. And then there's the red. The red is where the majority of the unreached people groups live. There's little to no Christians or churches there. The internet's usually restricted, and the Christianity is often oppressed, either culturally, legally, or both. And when we look at a map like this, I want to name a tension that we might feel right now. And the tension is this: most of us live in the green. I live in the green. I do ministry and life in Lynchburg, Virginia. But I still know and I still see people who are lost. I still see work that needs to be done. So, like, Austin, are you saying that the work we do here doesn't matter? Austin, are you saying that the lost person in the red is more important than the lost person here in Lynchburg or somewhere in the green? And my answer to that is an emphatic no, it's not more important. When it comes to the state of one's soul and one's standing before God, there is no difference. Without trusting in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus as payment for our sins, someone is separated from God forever. And when we talk about the need for people to go to the unreached, we are never, ever, ever minimizing the need that every single person has for Jesus, no matter where you live. Every person needs Jesus. This is one of the reasons we exist here as a church. It's why we're here in Lynchburg, Virginia, doing ministry, working for the kingdom. You can go outside and clearly see there's still work for Jesus to be done here. And if the churches in the green just decided, hey, it's looking good, we don't need to do anything else, then they become yellow and then red, and we got to start all over. And it's not an either or, it's a both and. So yes, there's work to be done in the green areas. The work matters. There's more Christians and churches needed everywhere in the world, no matter the color on this map. And it's okay to name the fact that there's a massive difference in the experience of the unsaved person's life, living here and living somewhere in the unreached areas of the world. And that difference comes down to access and to opportunity. And I want to bring this close to home and kind of lay out what this could look like. So I'm going to walk through the hypothetical experience of someone living in Lynchburg who does not know Jesus. Now, I understand this is very general. Just work with me here. But let's say his name is John. In Lynchburg, John's going to wake up. He's going to go out his door. Maybe he's going to go to work. Maybe he's going to go to a coffee shop. Maybe he's going to go to the park. I don't know. But throughout John's week in Lynchburg, Virginia, there's a strong chance he's going to come across, bump into, run into, say hello to at least one Christian a week. That's conservative, because I know we're a really churched city. But even if that doesn't happen, John's driving around. He can see churches as he's going from one place to another. He can go into any church on a Sunday. He can stop by during the week, ask the pastor for advice, for help. And even if he doesn't do that, there's bookstores, and most bookstores around here have Bibles. He can pick up a Bible and start reading it, or some places even have billboards around here. And I say all this to say that and there's churches in Lynchburg, by the way, who should be reaching out to John to get to know him. And so throughout John's life here in Lynchburg, he's going to have hundreds, if not thousands, of chances to at least hear the gospel clearly. Now, he'll have the choice, like, are you going to accept this or not? But he'll get to hear the truth of God. And now I want to walk through the life of someone from this village that you're going to see on your screens. This is a village I got to personally visit in the Atlas Mountains of North Africa a few years ago. It's not a Google stock photo. I took the photo. And it's home to generations of families. A few hundred people live here, and there's villages speckled all around the Atlas Mountains just like this one. And in this village, let's call him Samir. Samir will wake up. He's going to go about his day. Maybe he's a farmer, maybe he is a shepherd, maybe he works in the bakery. He's going to go throughout his day, he's going to do his job, he's going to come home, and he's not going to have a single encounter with the gospel of Jesus. Someone will be born in this village. Someone will live their entire life. They will grow up, become a teenager, adult, have a career, have a family, and they will die without ever having a single chance to hear the gospel one time. And it is true. It is absolutely true. They need the love and righteousness of Christ to cover them just as much as our friend in Lynchburg did. But did you see they do not have the same opportunities or access to hear it? And this is the practical, horrible, solemn reality of the red parts of our map. That all the red unreached areas are a map. Most people will be born, live their life, and die without a chance to hear the gospel a single time. 3 billion people. If you are a follower of Jesus, you cannot hear this and not be bothered. This grieves our Father in heaven, and it must grieve us. So what do we do about it? Where do we go from here? How do we solve this problem? God, we see the end. We see all these people, at least one person from each people group, will be worshiping forever one day in Revelation. But we're over here. How do we get there? God, what is your plan? And God answers that question throughout all of Scripture, showing he is a God of all peoples, saving all, building his kingdom. But one of the clearest places we see the answer is in Romans 10. So we're going to be in Romans 10 and Romans for the rest of our time together. In Romans 10, Paul is writing to the Christians of Rome, and he says this. He says, this is the message of faith. This is the gospel that we proclaim, that if you would confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart, resulting in righteousness, and one confesses with the mouth, resulting in salvation. If you're in here today and you don't know Jesus, this is the gospel 101. Like, we can figure out the rest together later, but would you place your faith in him today. I promise you will never regret it. Verse 11, for the scripture says, everyone who believes on him will not be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. There's no partiality with God. He saves all. The same Lord of all richly blesses anyone who will call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who trusts in Jesus will receive salvation. Jew, Greek, Jew, Palestinian, Ukrainian, Russian, Indian, Pakistani, American, Chinese, whatever background you have, all can come to Jesus. There is no distinction. Salvation is available to all. But then Paul shows us next, how do we get this salvation available to all, to the ends of the earth, so they can hear it? He shows us God's plan to get this message to the ends of the world. In verse 14, so all who call on the name will be saved. How then can they call on Jesus if they've not believed in him? And how can they believe in Jesus without hearing about him? And how can they hear about Jesus without someone to tell them? And how can someone go and tell them unless they are sent? It is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. But not all obeyed the gospel. Not all will decide to follow Jesus. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our message? But then, so faith comes from what is heard, and what is heard comes through the message about Christ. Paul makes it plain here in Romans. The unreached in the world cannot believe in Jesus and call on him as Lord unless they first hear about him. And they cannot hear about him unless someone goes to tell them. This is God's plan. God invites us to obey him, to join him on his mission, and to take the gospel to the ends of the earth, no matter the cost. And he does this by calling some to go and by calling every Christian, every church to help send. And this is not a calling of hierarchy. Both callings are beautiful and glorious when done in obedience to God. And we see this going and sending work together best in the life and ministry of Paul in the New Testament. Paul was convinced that the church was not meant to be stagnant, but it was meant to keep growing and growing to the places who had not yet heard about Jesus. We see the church in Acts start in Jerusalem, and it goes, and it spreads throughout Europe. Paul raises up leaders, and he says to these leaders, hey, stay in your city. Do ministry here. Raise up pastors here. And if some people have the call to go to the edges of the earth, send them with me. But you have work to do here in your city. And we see this practically let out in Romans 15. Paul's writing to the church in Rome, and he says this about his ministry and about his plans for ministry. He says, I have fully proclaimed the gospel of Jesus from Jerusalem all the way around to Illyricum, modern-day Croatia, Slovenia. My aim is to preach the gospel where Christ has not been named, so that I will not build on someone else's foundation. But as it's written in Isaiah, those who were not told about Jesus will see, and those who have not heard about Jesus will understand one day. And so that's why I've been prevented from coming to you, Romans. I've been doing the work of Jesus here, but now I no longer have any work to do in these regions. It's a crazy sentence. We're coming back to that. And I've strongly desired for many years to come to you when I finally travel to Spain. For I hope to see you when I pass through and to be assisted by you for my journey once I have first enjoyed your company. Paul says there's no more work to do in these regions. What does that mean? Because we know it does not mean that every single person there knew Jesus. Paul's not saying, hey, great job, guys, pack it up, we're done here. No, he's saying that there's enough churches, there's enough Christians here to continue the work of God, and it's time for him to move on to the next place that has not yet heard the gospel. And in this case, that was Spain. But he couldn't do this alone. It's not just him and everyone else. He's like, I need you to help me. He planned on stopping by the Christians in Rome to encourage him to spend time together and so they could spiritually and financially support him. Romans is the greatest missions support letter ever written. And in the same way, today, God still calls us to go and to send. We need people to go take the gospel to the unreached peoples of the world, because this is God's plan for reaching the ends of the earth. And we need people to send workers to the field, because cross-cultural missions is difficult and it requires spiritual, financial, and emotional support. The need is great, but so are the opportunities. In 2024, today, there are more opportunities to be involved globally than ever before because of how connected our world is. Paul could have never imagined a machine that takes you from one side of the world to the other through the air in a matter of hours. Paul could have never imagined that we can talk to people in live time in multiple languages through translators on a device we carry in our pocket. God is bringing people from unreached places to reached places as international students, as workers, as refugees, as immigrants. It's estimated that in the next 15 years, give or take, the Bible will be translated in every known language. Did you know that there's places and unreached areas of the world that will pay you to come be a Christian there? They will pay you to come teach English, to be a doctor, to be a nurse, to be an engineer. Closed countries will invite you to share the gospel. Just don't tell them that's why you're going there. And let me remind you, in case this morning's been a little too doom and gloom, that God has always been, currently is, and will always be working. Can we throw that map up one more time, please? On the map from earlier in the three colors, China used to be entirely red like 50, 60 years ago. And now China, which is a closed country, the government is trying to stamp out Christianity and they can't stop it. God is growing and multiplying and exploding that church. Latin America, sub-Saharan Africa, 150, 200 years ago, completely red, and now they are some of the strongest sending forces of missionaries to the unreached places that remain. Our partners in South Asia, Keith and Lori, just sent an update that God, a place of massive persecution, working among an unreached people group, that God has just recently softened the heart of the local leader, and they're about to do 50 public baptisms. This is a people group that for 2,000 years had not heard the gospel message until they accepted the call and they and a team went to them. Church, God is moving. He is alive and active and moving. The harvest is plenty and the harvest is ready, but the workers are few. And Jesus tells us to pray for more workers to go into the harvest. And so my question this morning, will you join him in the work that he is doing? I know this sounds crazy, but would everyone in here just come to a posture of surrender and simply just like ask him if he wants you to go? I know, like you might be retired, you might be just starting your career, you might be in the middle of a career, you might have kids, you might have a family. I know not everyone is called to go. Most of you probably won't be. This is true. God historically works by sending a few and having everyone else rally around them. But as followers of Jesus, can we at least agree that everyone is called to surrender their lives to Jesus? Every decision, Jesus, you need to affirm this. And I sometimes wonder, I do this too, I sometimes wonder if we take things off the table that maybe God wasn't asking us to take off the table yet. Do we sometimes close doors that Jesus didn't ask us to close yet? And if you ask him and the answer is no, then great. All I truly want for you is obedience to the Father. But if he says no, then ask him how he wants you to be involved in his great commission of reaching the ends of the earth with the gospel from Lynchburg, whether that's prayer, sending, whatever it is. At Gospel Community Church, I'm really proud to be a part of a church where one of our values says we are fiercely committed to the Great Commission. God is always, he's already doing the work of calling people from our church and using our church to send them to go. And this morning, we are going to hear a few more stories of that happening. And so, similar to last week, I'm going to ask